specialized in contemporary Middle Eastern societies with a focus on the relationships between biology and national identity. Ian earned a BA in biochemistry and cell biology from Trinity College Dublin. He has a PhD in molecular neuroscience from the University of Cambridge, and he received a master's degree in cultural and social anthropology from the University of Chicago and Harvard University. He completed a postdoctoral fellowship in science and democracy at the Edmund J. Safra Center in Ethics in Tel Aviv University in 2015 and 2016, and he has been a fellow and affiliate of Harvard's Program on Science, Technology, and Society since 2013. He's currently a PhD candidate in Middle Eastern Studies and Anthropology here at Harvard, earning a secondary field in SDS. His dissertation focuses on biobanking and ethnic genetics in Israel and Qatar, and discusses the consequences of precision medicine initiatives on ethnic and national identity and discourses over rights to citizenship. However, today we will be hearing from Imoni's new project, which is a cultural study of wine production in the West Bank area of Israel and Palestine, where wine science is entangled with the historical imagination of indigeneity that naturalizes Jewish presence on this highly contested territory.
And so this is a brand new project. I started this summer in June and July in Israel. I spent a month in Jerusalem and traveled to various wineries investigating how it is that wine is more than just wine in this highly fraught area. And so I'm going to present today on this new work, and hopefully we'll have a discussion. I welcome your questions, criticism, feedback. Really, it's at a very early stage, so any suggestions that can help me go on the right track would be very appreciated. Toro Winery sits in the disputed West Bank area between the Palestinian cities Nablus and Ramallah, in the small Jewish settlement of Rachalim. And I should say that Rachalim is actually the Hebrew word for the dual form of Rachel, so it means two Rachels, and it's named Rachalim because two women called Rachel were killed in political violence in the area. And I say this at the outset, not just to emphasize how fraught the territory is, but how political violence tends to bolster or be read as an encouragement for a settlement in this area. Although Tor has won over 40 awards at international wine competitions, the winemakers face serious challenges. We've lost a lot of friends over the years. We've had three explosions in the vineyard, says Verit Ben Saadon, co-owner of Toro Winery. It's not the pursuit of wine awards that underpin Verit and her husband Erez's perseverance. Rather, bonding to the land is our purpose, she tells me in an interview. For many Jewish residents of this area, settling the land is the fulfillment of a mitzvah, a religious duty which many regard as an imperative. Their dedication, therefore, lies at the intersection of religious Zionism and commercial agriculture in contemporary Israel. Verit describes the success of their winery as a miracle, something that cannot simply be explained by hard work. In fact, they see the success of the winery as part of the divine plan. They believe that wine production in the land of Israel was prophesied in the Hebrew Bible, where Jeremiah says that Jews will return and plant vineyards in Samaria. Indeed, as you will see in this short clip that I'm going to play now, Verit's husband Erez talks about settlement in the area, and he sees settlement as about not just living in a particular territory, but connecting with God, connecting with the land, and imagining a prosperous future. A prosperous future hinging on agriculture. And so I'll play this to give you a sense of the messianic energy, the enthusiasm, and the passion that these settlers actually hold for being in this part of the world.
החלומות שלי זה שכל האזור של הר ברכה, כן, שכם, אלון מורה, הרבל, יהיה עיר, עיר גדולה, ענקית, שכל העמק, העמק למטה, העמק המשמטה, יהיה חקלאות. שבעצם במדינת ישראל יהיו כבר 14 מיליון יהודים. 14 מיליון, אם לא יותר אולי עד אז, זה כבר יכול להיות גם כן 20 מיליון יהודים. ובזאת השם ש... 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 עם ישראל יחזור לארצו, שיבנה את המקדש כמובן, ושהקדוש ברוך הוא כבר יתגלה אלינו, שהקדוש ברוך הוא כמו פעם, יהיה לו קשר איתנו, קשר ישיר איתנו, שיהיה לו קשר ישר איתנו, כמו פעם. ובעזרת השם, עם ישראל יחזור לארצו, וזהו.
Okay, so you can see he has a dream. The dream is about settling the land, a huge city based on agriculture. And not only is it a secular vision, it's not a secular vision at all, it's about connecting with God as was imagined, was achieved before the Jewish exile and that there was a Jewish temple in Jerusalem. For Erez and many others, this dream of Jewish resettlement in the West Bank or in the area of Samaria is prophesied in the Hebrew Bible. And these are the two passages that are most often cited. Now, wine is in the West Bank area of Israel and Palestine are now producing high quality wine. But growing grapes and making wine are clearly much more than commercial viticulture. They're a way of re-establishing ancient Jewish winemaking practices and imagining a connection to biblical sites. West Bank wineries are a small subset of the 200 or 300 plus wineries in Israel and Palestine, but these Jewish wineries are on the precarious frontier of Israeli society, sitting outside the internationally recognized territory of the State of Israel. They also happen to be on a series of biblical sites. Wine production in this context mediates a collective identity and naturalizes Jewish presence on this highly contested territory. So this project asks, how is winemaking part of nation building in the 21st century? There are three key issues at stake. The first is, how is wine important for Jewish culture? So the question is wine, does wine have a role or a status in Jewish culture above other cultures or above secular society? Why is building wineries on biblical sites part of Jewish messianism or the realization of prophecy? And how is high-tech science now being employed to make wines from so-called indigenous varietals? By addressing these three entangled issues, I aim to tell the story of the West Bank settlement projects through the lens of winemaking, tracking how wine production mediates a collective identity and establishes an historical imaginary that underpins the nation state and consequently naturalizes Jewish presence. At this point, I want to make a statement about the politics of researching this highly fraught area. In giving voice to the worldviews of the settlers, there's a danger that the scholar inadvertently normalizes their worldview. This is not my intention. This project does not set out to argue the case for the settlements, but nor is it a study of winemaking the settlements with an agenda to delegitimize their beliefs. Rather, I'm asking, how is it in these highly controversial communities, how these highly controversial communities are held together, and specifically, how is it that winemaking has a particularly powerful role in establishing an aesthetic and spiritual connection to the land? This is an important question, not only for explaining how and why these settlements have come into being, but also to illuminate the difficulties and issues at stake if a peace deal were to be enacted with the Palestinians. So this is not an advocacy project, but rather an attempt to deploy social science to provide a better understanding of this highly contested territory. I had the pleasure recently to attend a lecture by this Israeli author, Asaf Gavron, and also to have breakfast with him, actually. He wrote this novel, Hagivah, in Hebrew, which is translated as The Hilltop. It's the first real novel about the settlers, and tells the story of how a settlement comes into being. He's written several novels, but this is one that he wanted to write because he felt that these people were poorly understood, and he wanted to essentially tell their story in a piece of fiction. And so he gave a lecture, and I asked the question, what are the difficulties of studying the settlers, writing about them, normalizing them, humanizing them? And he says, well, first of all, you have to recognize the political stakes, but also you need to recognize that these are human beings. And for some people, writing about these people as human beings is also taking a political stance. So just to say at the outset, I'm writing about these people, and that itself is a political choice. So why are Jews there? It's clearly a rough neighborhood. This area in the West Bank, which Jews call the Shomron or Samaria, is very important for religious Jews. From Nablus, or what religious Jews would call Shechem in the north, all the way to Jerusalem and Hebron, all the way south to Beersheba and the desert, this is what religious Jews call Derech HaAvot, or the path of the patriarchs. So Jacob, Abraham, Sarah, these are the sites that where they're mentioned to have walked along in the Hebrew Bible. And these are also the areas where these settlements are located and where the wineries I'm going to talk about are located. Crucially, building contemporary wineries on these biblical sites on this route helps to reinforce the Jewish national identity. And this is where the research begins. For example, here is where everything starts. Jews as a nation started here, says Amichai Lori, owner of award-winning Shiloh Winery, which he proudly names after the religious settlement where the Bible says the tabernacle was erected following the Israelites' exodus from Egypt. So here you can see the label from the bottle of wine, the Cabernet Sauvignon Secret Reserve, with a pencil drawing of the tabernacle or the Mishkan, which was putatively located at Shiloh after the Israelites arrived into Israel. The tabernacle is the container that held the tablets upon which the Ten Commandments were inscribed by God on Mount Sinai. This was the portable Holy of Holies before the Jewish temple was built in Jerusalem. Lori, who exports over 100,000 bottles of wine a year, sees wine production in Shiloh as part of the process of redemption. The Bible, he tells me, says we will know redemption is near when branches of fruit will flourish. Now, Lori has a Facebook page and he posts about wine tasting and tours of his winery. So although it's putatively located on an ancient biblical site, it's using the latest in social media to transmit its message. And I mention this just to raise an issue about what is ethnographic fieldwork in the 21st century. On the one hand, one has to arrive and experience the local environment, but on the other hand, one's informants are constantly reaching out and transmitting their message. And so ethnography in the 21st century is quite delocalized. Shiloh, however, is just one of many sites in the region that have importance for Jewish history. A few miles south is the religious settlement of Beit El, named after the biblical site where Jacob spent a night sleeping on a rock and had his dream of angels ascending and descending from heaven. The vines of Beit El are rooted in biblical tradition, reads the brochure from the boutique winery, defined as under 100,000 bottles a year. Winery owner Hillel Mann grew up in the United States and studied agriculture in California before moving to Beit El for Zionism. He brings me on a walking tour of Beit El and shows me an ancient wine press from the time of the Second Temple period. On a walk around Beit El, Hillel also shows me the site of Jacob's rock, the site where Jacob putatively spent a night sleeping. Nearby, he also shows me a cave that he says looks like a Second Temple cave. This, he says, gets people really excited. Hitch a ride up the steep hill into the guarded settlement of the Sargot, a few miles outside Ramallah, I pass security barriers plastered with Hebrew posters celebrating the 50 years of Zionism, building, and sovereignty since Israel expanded into the West Bank in the 1967 Six-Day War. And since then, in September, there were further celebrations in commemoration of what they're called the sovereignty in the West Bank, essentially. At Psagot, I meet Yaakov Orie, chief winemaker at Psagot. Orie is warm and gentle and offers me a coffee as we sit at the table in the winery visitor center. The walls boast dozens of awards, and glass tiles offer views of the cellar below, stocked with oak barrels of previous harvests. Orie shares his interests and hopes for the winery as we sample a glass of Psagot's premier wine, The Peak. Psagot has a very recognizable brand. The bottle is adorned with a gold coin that is found in a cave near where the initial winery was established. The original coin is dated from the time of the famous Jewish revolt against the Romans. Psagot's output is 300,000 bottles a year, about 70% of which is exported. Orie's agenda is not to grow, however, but to focus on quality. He sees great potential in the Israeli wine industry, especially because of the exceptional quality grapes that can be produced from the unique terroir of the Judean hills and Shomron region, which he describes as half Middle Eastern and half Mediterranean. And by that he means long, dry summers with a very wide daily temperature range. And he explained to me that the large daily temperature range allows a huge amount of sugar to accumulate in the grape, and that it's cold at night prevents the sugar from returning to the leaves, and this creates a very ripe grape through a long, warm summer season. I should say at this point that terroir in this context is more than the physical characteristics of the land and the environment. As other scholars of Israeli viticulture have reported, it's the person who gives the work an identity to terroir. There's an emotional connection, an emotional identity to a particular piece of earth. Similarly, in France, an article in the New York Times wrote, "The importance of terroir to the French psyche and self-image is difficult to overestimate, because it is a concept almost untranslatable, combining soil, weather, region, and notions of authenticity, of genuineness and particularity, of roots and home, in contrast to globalized products designed to taste the same everywhere." It is this conception of terroir, connoting a local and grounded authenticity, that I wish to pay attention to in the West Bank wine industry. I'm curious to attend to this kind of transcendent relationship between human and non-human materials. In other words, how is it that winemaking mediates an aesthetic and emotional connection to this contested territory? Further north is Harbrecha, often called a radical outpost settlement. Harbrecha houses 350 families. And I know that it's 350 families because when I was hitching a ride from Ariel to Harbrecha in a car with three Orthodox ladies, two of whom were pregnant, I asked how many people live in Harbrecha, and they told me in families. And I found out later that it's commonly described, the population in the settlements is commonly described in families and not in numbers, because in Jewish tradition, I'm told, there's a taboo on counting individuals. Harbrecha is perched in the Shomron Mountains, overlooking the Palestinian city of Nablus. And religious Jews call Nablus Shechem, and several would tell me that it's only called Nablus because the Palestinians can't pronounce the real name Neapolis. It's a tense relationship, with some elements, perhaps, of jealousy between the settlers and the more authentic Arab residents. And I think you can track this with the appropriation of various Arab decorations and lifestyle objects, nargilas, etc. Winemaker Nir Levy tells me, "This is Bible land. Harbrecha is beside the burial ground of Joseph, the son of Jacob." Furthermore, a territorial connection underpins Levy's winemaking philosophy. A banner hangs over the wine bar, reading "Wine, Land, and Culture," and the connection between them. And I find this fascinating because, on the one hand, this is my research question: what is the role of wine in connecting people to the land? And on the other hand, it's the explicit ideology and motive for this winery. This, of course, raises the question: what is special about the role of wine in Jewish culture? Jewish halakha, or traditional religious law, demands that the handlers of the grapes during wine production be religious Shabbat observant Jews. The strict rules emerge from ancient times when Jews were afraid they would drink wine made with pagan practices. Consequently, the Israeli wine industry has historically been branded as kosher wine, deemed of lower quality to world wines. But this label is dissolving, and export is a growing part of the wine industry. And here comes the transnational dimension of the project. Amin Ahari, a New York-based wine importer of Israeli wines, says Israeli wine is making a name for itself. While Israeli wine was once $13 a bottle, now a single vineyard will retail for $45 a bottle and upwards. The high price can be attributed to the cost of labor and water in Israel, but American Jews still want to buy expensive Israeli wine because they feel closer to Israel than to California. Powerful narratives behind their product, selling a connection to both the Bible and to the ancient winemaking traditions of the region. Indeed, for religious Jews, wine is about more than good taste. Jews use wine ceremonially in blessing and marking important religious occasions and celebrations. Wine is essential for weddings, Brit Milah, which is circumcision, every Jewish holiday, and every Friday night dinner. Religious Jews often state that wine has the special capacity to lift the physical and mundane earthly events, like conjugal union or eating, to a higher spiritual level of significance. To underscore this point, here's a photo from the first winery I visited. A newlywed couple came to take photos in the vineyard. Vineyards provide a pleasant place, with good light for photography, of course, but the choice to come to a vineyard and not, say, a beautiful building speaks to both the deep-rooted historical importance of agriculture in Israeli society, and perhaps also the ceremonial status of wine in Jewish life. And another narrative to support this suggestion is that when I visited Sagot and I asked Yaakov what his plans were for the future, he told me that he'd like to make a sparkling white wine, like champagne. And when I asked him, when can we expect to see it, or, you know, what's the hesitation, he said, well, you know, Jews drink wine solemnly and ceremonially, while, you know, we don't spray it, you know, all over the place like champagne. And so he had apprehensions about whether a sparkling white wine would be received well by a Jewish society. Founder of US-based marketing company Westbank Wines, Greg Svilar, who we are honored to have here today, says that we can't have our culture without wine. It transcends connoisseurism. And indeed, winemaking in Israel is building on a long history. So a quick side note on the prehistory of wineries in Israel. Local wine initially became famous in the 4th and 5th century, the Byzantine period, when the Romans distributed it. After a long break during Muslim and Ottoman rule, wine production resumed in the 19th century, when Baron Rothschild aptly brought French varietals to Palestine. It was not, however, until the late 20th century that Jewish wine production focused on quality and chose grapes with a wide market appeal, such as Merlot and Chardonnay. Golan Heights Winery in the north was one of Israel's first wineries to focus on quality, and it was established in 1983. And before quality wine emerged from Golan Heights, they brought a team of European wine consultants over to basically teach them how to produce high quality wine. And this also, in the context of Israeli history, this is after the 1977 Mahapach, which is the overturn of the socialist government that dominated the early years of the Israeli state, and the emergence of a consumer economy, and the overall the deregulation of the market. Today, this wine region is yielding grapes of outstanding quality. In the British Decanter, a blind tasting competition, Westbank wines have scored a series of 90 points plus. And so the peak, this is one I've tasted, and the Hebron Reserve I have not tasted. This is outside of the area I'm talking about, but nonetheless part of the Westbank. Establishing wineries on biblical sites only enhances their brand. But these wineries also aim to be successful in the non-kosher market too. Crucially, they're striving for excellent quality wine that is commercially successful globally, but they enjoy the metaphysical add-on of being from ancient biblical sites. However, not all West Bank wines dwell so heavily on the biblical past. A few miles outside Jerusalem is Ophrah, one of the largest settlements in the West Bank, and home to boutique winery Tanya. Winemaker Yoram Cohen's face is tanned and weathered from years of sun and outdoor activities, but his slim frame moves with the agility of a man half his age. I find him in his backyard, washing cherries with his son amidst blaring Hebrew blues rock music. He greets me with bright eyes and a firm handshake. He's a busy man, he tells me, with 8 children and hobbies including skiing, gliding, diving, writing, and painting. We taste his tannic and fruit chocolate noted red wine as he plays a Cat Stevens song on his phone. The lyrics, he tells me, catch the relationship between man and wine. Cohen defines himself as a pacifist who fell in love with the area years before there was any settlement, when he was a young schoolboy visiting an archaeological site in the area. Having pursued careers in journalism and photography, he turned his hand to winemaking as a hobby with an initial purchase of 300 kilos of local grapes and a plan to make just 200 bottles of wine for friends and family. Tanya now produces 30,000 bottles a year. When I ask Cohen about his opinion on the political problems of the area, he says that when his 14-year-old nephew was killed in a Jerusalem terrorist attack, he felt mercy for the perpetrator, claiming he who hurts himself, kills his own life. Cohen has named each cuvée after his children, and he plans to make a brandy from white grapes. Despite the asserted historical connection and the biblical stories, wine production in this area, the challenge, several winemakers tell me, is that Israel does not have a wine identity. As one winemaker tells me, while Italy has Barolo and Nero d'Avola, and Australia has Shiraz, the first association with kosher wine is bad. We don't have an identity because we don't have varietals. And so wine scientists are now addressing this problem. Gvoat is a boutique winery in the settlement of Givat Harel near Shiloh, and has the mission of renewing the winemaking tradition and connection to the land of Israel. Winemaker Eliav Miller takes me on a tour of the winery and shows me an ancient wine press. So you can see him pointing emphatically to this wine press. And so how this is supposed to work is the flat areas where the grapes are laid down and they're crushed, and then the juice flows into the cavity where it's stored. Gvoat is producing wine from so-called indigenous varietals, like the Jindali grape, which yields a fresh and crisp white wine. Such indigenous wine, he tells me, has wide market appeal. Even without tasting it, everybody wants it, he tells me. Indigenous varietals, however, could also help solve the industry's wine identity problem, creating a unique image for Israel in the wine market. But making indigenous biblical era wine takes the latest in agricultural science. Gvoat's winemaker is Dr. Shibi Drori, who also happens to be the head of Ariel University's Wine Research Center, where he's actively molding Israel's wine identity. What are we? New world, old world, or ancient world? The task at hand, he asserts, is to find ancient grape varietals and understand the ancient winemaking. Drori is collaborating with archaeologists who found grape seeds at ancient sites, and his lab is performing genetic analysis and 3D laser scanning of the seeds to identify the varietals that were used to make wine in the Second Temple period. So they found more than 600 varietals in Israel. They sent out research to find every vine they could find whatsoever, and they found 600, which after analysis were narrowed down to 70 unique indigenous varietals. These are now growing at Drori's laboratory and research winery. So he actually has a research lab that does chemical analysis of the grapes and the seeds. He has a research vineyard with short lines, short vines, where he's able to grow just enough to experiment with the grapes. And he has a research winery where he'll brew small amounts to assess the quality. So far, 20 varietals have the right sugar, color, acidity, and complexity for quality wine production. I walk with Drori from his biology lab to his research winery, where he's experimenting with an indigenous red grape to make what he calls Yain Shemesh, or sun wine. This grape accumulates a very high level of sugar and yields a smoky and raisiny red wine. So this wine has about 16% alcohol and a high residual sugar content. So as I was tasting it, he said, "Tastes like a port, right?" I said, "Yeah, it does." He said, "Yeah, but it's better than a port, because a port is fortified, has alcohol added to it, whereas this is all made from a single fermentation, and that itself is very unique." This is a style of wine Drori believes was produced in ancient times, one that could be transported easily and diluted to decontaminate water. When I ask about biblical narratives, Drori says, "Telling stories is very nice, but high-end research makes the story more credible. If he succeeds, the Israeli wine industry can say to the world, come and taste the wines of the Bible, and they are good." Drori also thinks that biblical era wine will have appeal to Christians around the world, who can imagine that they're drinking the same wine Jesus did at the Last Supper.